Hey guys, it's Kelly here with Good Dogs Minnesota. I'm sorry that I'm late. My wife was not feeling very good, so I was kind of a one-woman show tonight with the dogs and the kid and everything. So she's feeling better though. So sorry I'm late. I'll introduce myself quick. If you don't know who I am, my name is Kelly Zank. I am a dog trainer in Minnesota. Oh yeah, she's sorry, thanks, Jess. Yeah, she doesn't feel very good. And of course she had to like not feel very good on one of our busiest evenings, but you know, it happens. Yeah, dog trainer, Minnesota. I specialize in pet dog training, off-leash obedience, and some behavior modification. Just so you know, Blue here is probably going to sing the song of his people for us. He's on place right now, and he's not very happy about it. He's in that point of his training where he actually has to stay on place when there's distraction, and there's stuff going on, even though he wants to be involved. He has to stay there, stay on place. So, he might whine a little bit, which is fine. I just let him whine. Unless he starts to get. Oh, you want to see him? Okay, hold on. I'm going to be stealthy about it, though, because I don't want him to get his attention and get him all excited. Because then I'll just have problems. He's actually doing a lot better today. He actually had to stay upstairs on place while Marley was out. And it was hard for him, really hard for him, but he did it. Yeah, he did it. He's doing good. We just went outside and I threw the ball for him. We worked on out, so we played chuck it for like a half hour. And so he's much better after that. See, now he's relaxing. He's getting it. It can be taught. Good boy. And all of his stuff is Blue. All of his stuff that goes home, his leash, he got a new leash, and his e-collar's Blue. He's got his Blue e-collar. And he's excited for all of his Blue stuff. Or maybe I'm just more excited about his Blue stuff. What's up, Stephanie? Hey, I'm gonna get back to you. I know you messaged me and then I totally forgot. I'm sorry, I get busy. But I'm gonna message you soon, tonight, when I'm get done with this, I promise. I really don't have anything to talk about tonight, today, other than I mean Blue had his first field trip today, which went very, very well. He had a meltdown once. He just was a little overwhelmed with everything. We went to Fleet Farm and worked on what I call the gauntlet, and it's when there's a busy time at like a department store. When you walk by the front with the sliding glass doors in the summer and people are walking in cars and the flowers are all out, you know, and we had to walk through that a few times. And by the third time he did wonderful. He did great. He's like, oh, I get it now. This is the same thing as I'm supposed to do, but it's just a little bit different, right? So he did a good job. Everybody's afraid of him though. I was really shocked. I got like, there's two people that like remarked, I mean, loud enough for me to hear, which I was just like, really? Like there, I don't know. One woman, I heard her, she said, that's a freaky looking dog. And I was like, dang, man. All right. Whatever. Which, and honestly, it brings up something that one of, you know, one thing that he is big and he is scary looking kind of, you know, and he's intact. You know, he's over a year. He's between 1 and 2 years old, and he really likes people. And you know, a few times there was somebody that you know we'd walk by, and somebody came out the sliding glass door, and right in front of us. And his initial reaction was to be like, "Whoa!" You know, and that can really scare somebody. I mean, an 85-pound pit bull just coming at you chest first, and I can see where. I mean, that's a problem, you know, just even that little like one step forward to cut you off and to what's that, can actually cause big problems. Because if somebody reacted to him, like got scared and spooked him, he could actually like get more intense and bark and boof and act out, because he is kind of he's a little insecure sometimes, which is where we get some of his reactivity. And he doesn't have a lot of reactivity. I think it's mostly age more than it is anything else. But he just needs a lot of exposure. So he needs a lot of practice. Andy asked, how do you determine when a dog is ready to go visit a store? Well, I take him to the store and I see what happens. No, I do a lot of, I mean, within the store, the rules are, I want them to at least understand what heel means, right? Because that's when they're at the store, in public, I want them to just be in heel and really focus on paying attention to me, I guess. I mean, I don't need them to be like super engaged to the point where they like can't look at anything else, but I want them, starting to get that point where they kind of realize that like people around or things going on around me, I don't have to be involved in. They're none of my business. Right. So first I do a lot of work around here that there's the where there's like distractions and he's just not allowed to be involved in it. I kind of have a setup here. Like I have chickens, he's got to hang out where the chickens are and not worry about it. I work on heel, sit stays down. I don't really do sit stays. I think sit stays are so overrated. I don't do a lot of sit anyway, but, with anything really. But downstays when the chickens are out, and working on him just kind of paying attention when there's stuff going on and actually like moving away from stuff that he finds exciting. So if I'm outside working on heel with him, I'll get him close to like let's say Maddie, or if Amy's working outside with like tools, get him close and he'll kind of get excited about the tools, and I'll immediately direct him to either with the, depending on if he was good at the e-collar, I could tap him with the e-collar, come on, and he turns good and reward. And we learn that like, hey, there's something going on, but I just have to like turn away from it. And then I'll bring him into a store or start outside the store, probably. If you're nervous, I would just like go to the parking lot and start there, and walk around with different sounds and people walking by and carts, and really just try to maintain what you learn, which is just heel and stay calm and move away from stuff that you find, concerning or unpleasant, or and move away from excitement if I ask you to. And that's pretty much it. I don't expect the dog to be like super, they don't have to be like super obedient right away. It's just like being really simple. And I've done where I have dogs that are more sensitive to that type of stuff, and I'll actually just go to a parking lot and I'll start in the parking lot. Or we do the rule of five, which is you go to five different places 5 days in a row. So for 5 days, I would go to the parking lot of Petco. And then for 5 days, I would practice going in and out of the sliding glass doors. And then 5 days, I would practice going down two aisles. Then for another 5 days, I would practice going around another aisle, and I'd slowly build up from there. And then I would go to a different place. So, and you can break that up rule of five any way you want to. You can start with like super baby steps. Or you could do, if he's doing great, just kind of push it. And you kind of got to read your own dog. One thing about going in public, though, the best thing to do is make is quality versus quantity. So really getting in your car, taking the dog to the parking lot of Petco, working on heel in the parking lot for 10 minutes, going home, doing that again the next day or 2 days later, and just making it part of your routine is way more effective than bringing him to Petco and like getting them through the door, and they're super excited, and they're like, oh God, there's ferrets and birds and people and dog, and really kind of flooding them with all that stuff, and then expecting them to be able to work on heel or things that you're working on. Could be something else. Is can be hard. So I just, take it slow. It's my thing. And if, Andy, you have your own dog, so you can take all the time in the world, really. Are you concerned about her going? She's a girl, I think, right? Going to the store? Or were you just asking, just out of personal interest, I guess? If I have a board and train, like a 5 week board and train, we definitely will start going on field trips in the 3rd week. We have to be. going on field trips in the third week, because if they're going home at five, but if I have a 5 week board and train, I should be able to bring them back being able to walk through a pretty heavy gauntlet with no problem. People, dogs, other animals, if possible. Yeah, and that, I mean, that's part of what they pay for, so kind of have to do that. Just says like Zeus and same age. Yep. There are pains. Oh, okay. Yeah, the 1 year olds, 1 to 2 years old is a tough age, I think. They're big, they're strong, yet they're kind of still like mentally weenies and resort to being offensive when they don't know what else to do or they have a surge of emotion, adrenaline, and they and it's pretty typical of the age, but it also is something that we want to get a handle on really, really soon. I want them to get a handle before they're two, because once they start really practicing that behavior a lot and it starts getting them the results that they want. So if the dog like barks and gets nervous and, at something, and the person runs away or goes, whoa, and backs up, then the dog becomes really confident in that behavior. And we don't want that. Or the opposite, where they're like, oh, I want to see you, I want to see you, and they get whiny, which is what he does a lot. He gets surprised by people, but then he like wants to say hi, but he's not really sure. So he tends to like whine, and then like want to run up and then back and up. And if we're allowing him to like greet people like that and allowing him to get reinforced for that like excitedness, he's just going to get more and more excited whenever he sees a person, which is just going to make him impossible to walk or be on the leash or anything. So we don't want that. So yeah, that's it. I want to make a little half announcement. That our we've decided that not to keep. We were thinking about adopting our foster, and we have decided not to. So she is available for adoption. The reason we've decided not to, I really, really wanted to. I think she's a great dog. I love her, and it's going to be really hard to try to place her somewhere else or to, adopt her out. But she's a Malinois. And like any Malinois, she is awesome to train. She's a complete maniac, awesome in public. No problems. She's good with kids. She's good with other dogs. She's good with people. She would totally eat my chickens if I gave her the okay, but she doesn't because she's a good girl. And she's great out in public. She's awesome. Yeah, she's crate trained, but it, like any Malinois, she is a little bit hard to live with on a day-to-day basis. So she is has to be doing something all the time. She has a hard time just like laying down. Unlike my 10-year-old dog Marley, who will pretty much just do whatever I'm doing, and then Hogarth, who is a very, very serious field dog, but when he's in the house not working, he's just fine laying around, which is great. She can't turn off, so she has to be like, we have to put her in place to turn her off, or put her in her kennel to turn her off. So, and no. Sorry, guys, hold on. Nope. No, place. He hears my Maddie's running around upstairs, and he hears, so he's a little concerned. Yeah, she needs more than basically that we can give her right now. With the two dogs that I have, with the farm growing, with my business growing, and I'm becoming very, very busy, which is great. I'm super excited. Put her in service. I know the problem is we are looking for anybody that would be willing that wants to put her in service work. The problem is that she can't lay down at home, so she wouldn't be she doesn't have that She doesn't have that ability. I think though that she'd be amazing at precision obedience. I think she'd be amazing at any sort of detection scent work. There's a video if you scroll down of her, and she'll search out a ball. I could throw a ball in my, I could plant a ball in our 10-acre field, and she will find it. I swear to God, she would find it, and she won't stop until she found it. The first 2 weeks I had her here before she went on heartworm treatment, which is another thing. She has heartworm, and so a lot of places won't take her for training because she's had heartworm and she was heartworm positive. I threw a snowball and she did not stop finding it until I brought her in. Like she didn't get it that like the snowball disappeared. And she's very frustrated. But yeah, the more busy that I get with my own dogs and kid and family, and we do want to have another kid at some point, she will end up spending more and more time on place and in her kennel, and that's not fair. So we're looking for a place for her to go, for her to be adopted. I think that she'd be great as an only dog. Not that she's not really great with dogs, but she just requires a lot of one-on-one time. I haven't seen it from her, but with a dog that is softer, I mean, she could bully another dog around a little bit. I haven't seen it at our house because we run a pretty tight ship, and Hogarth is pretty good about that stuff. He holds his own a little bit, but she could get a little bossy. And I wouldn't suggest her in a house with younger kids just because younger kids take up a lot of time and she takes up some time. So I think she'd be honestly a great dog for anybody aspiring to be a dog trainer because she will make you look so good. Like, she makes me look good every day. She also, I mean, she's off leash trained. She's getting to the end of e-collar training right now. I still have to put her through some things, but she, nope, no. She, sorry, I was watching. She comes with free training too. I'll do three free sessions with her, three of them. Free sessions. So, just anybody who knows if you're from Minnesota, anyone? Oh, Brooke. Yep. She's great. Brooke does our house sitting and house setter. She is wonderful. She's a little quirky. But again, she's a great dog in public. She's wonderful. She's just hard to live with on a daily basis, which is the case with the breed. That's what you get when you get a Malinois. I don't think she's would be good for sport. I don't think she has quite the defense drive in her. Okay, Jess, we'll go back to that. If you guys have any questions about Dasha, let me know. But I answer questions. Jess asked, what about a dog that listens better with e-collar on? Like Zeus pushes me sometimes when he knows he doesn't have it on. Sure. One thing is he's collar wise, which is that's what that means, that he's collar wise, so he knows that he has the e-collar on. It probably means that you took off the e-collar too soon. And I'm not sure what you went through the trainer that lives by you guys. I'm not sure what method that he used. But typically speaking, you want to keep the e-collar on them pretty much most of the day until they're really, really out of the avoidance phase. So that's probably a good 3 months-ish. The other thing too is that you probably are depending too much on the tool and not enough on the relationship per se, right? E-collars are great tools, but they're not like problem solvers. So if you're only using it to tell him no, he probably A, doesn't quite understand it, and B, has become collar wise. So he just knows he has it on. He knows he's going to get a tweak if he doesn't do it, but typically speaking, you want to go through escape and avoidance, which in doing so, you'll avoid the dog becoming reliant on the e-collar. Because by the end, like by the end of my program, the dogs aren't really using the e-collar anymore. I mean, they have it on, they use it if it's necessary, but they're not using it anymore. They should just be doing what they're supposed to do. Well, that's the issue, and we don't always have it on. If you know, what are you using it for? Like, what? Give me an example, Jess. Like, what's going on that he's like becoming collar-wise and it's a problem? I guess that would be good. He was awesome at listening starting the e-collar. Now he doesn't listen as well without it. But we randomly use it. Okay. Again, give me an example. I'm not sure. There's a few different ways to use the collar that, I mean, there's a lot of really big name trainers. I th think that the trainer that you went to went through Robin McFarlane, I think her name is, right? Robin McFarlane. She uses it differently than I use it right now. So, as far as I know from her way of using it, she uses a lot of preemptive stuff. Where I will use more the knee po po style, so Barbalone style. So yeah, I guess I need a little more example. But if you're using it randomly, then that's going to be a problem for sure. Because then he's gonna just he's just going to make the association that he knows when it's on, and he, doesn't listen when it's on. If you're having an issue with it, though, what I would do is I would take him off of it for like 2 months, or maybe like a month, and then start fresh and clean again. Just like start over. That would probably be better. Typically, if you're using the e-collar for like when you're saying the command and using the stim and then rewarding saying the command like at the same time or just after, and you're always using it as a precursor to a reward every time, the dog's going to start associating. It's going to be just like the clicker, right? And then the dog's going to be like, oh, well, I really don't want to do that right now. And then you're going to have to dial up and go, oh, well, I know I have to do that, versus using it with escape and avoidance. You're not necessarily, you're only influencing the dog in a behavior they already know, if that makes sense. You can start it out on a green dog, but you have to go really, really slow and you have to do a lot more kind of like little tiny tweaking and molding. But typically, sorry guys, typically speaking, if you do this, if you go through a really long, a really good avoidance phase and you get your reps in, you shouldn't have to use it. The other thing I would say is make sure that you are actually getting your reps in before you're trying to use it functionally. Like, you have to practice for a big game. So if for a recall, for example, I probably recall Blue right now like 30 or 40 times a day. And he's right now, he only probably gets the stim, I don't know, maybe like a handful of those times. And it's when there's a lot of distraction. And I also will even have to get to the point where I have to make sure that he gets a little bit of stim because it's going to get too long where he hasn't had it yet anymore. And he's going to forget. So I don't want him to forget yet. It's too soon. I want to, I have to like get my reps in and do a lot of repetition, a lot of repetition, a lot of repetition. Pretty much if he feels the e-collar, I want him turning his butt around, just like boop, and coming at me hot. Ready to get a reward or get to jump on me or whatever I let him do for coming when he's called. So, I don't know if that's answering your question, but getting a lot of reps in before you're actually trying to use it in real life is really, really important. Well, there's health issues every day. Oh, yeah. That's true. I mean, you can do a lot with it. Just if you're gonna, if you're gonna start it, I would honestly put him on like a program, meaning that he doesn't just lay around all day in the house. Like you actually put him in the kennel or have him on place, and then only have him out to work with him for a little while. Like put him as if he was in a boarding train. Right now, the boarding trains, they don't, I mean, they get a few sessions a day, like 15, 20 minutes of just like romping around doing whatever, and I play with them. But they're working if they're out. So if you can manage that, and then when he's not working, I mean, have him in his kennel. You know, as long as he's fed and watered and gone outside and got a little run around, he should be fine. And then only have him out when he's working. Sorry, I'm watching Blue Be Mischievous. Nope. Place. 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 Good boy. He doesn't want to stay there. He wants to get up. Yes. Good boy. Sorry, he got up. I wasn't able to sit here. Two things at once. It's hard sometimes. Yeah, I would just honestly, and if you have to, just don't use it. Put it away for a while and then start over when things are better. It's much better to do that than to do it half, just to do it like only sometimes or do it randomly. I would much rather you just put it away and then bring it back out when you're able to do it, pretty much. And I do want to be careful about like e-collar questions. I need to start doing more e-collar videos. I actually got a sound box so that I can do videos and you can actually hear it when I'm using the button, which is nice. I've been playing with it for a little while and it's pretty cool. And I will do more stuff with it and start going into detail with it more. The reason I haven't is because it's I'm still working on taking what I do and being able to tell the story, being able to like moderate it so that it's effective in a kind of a learning and informational way. Right now it's really a lot of muscle memory and I'm having trouble doing what, you know, explaining what I'm doing. Because a lot of it is feel, a lot of it's muscle memory, and it's a hard thing to kind of explain, really. So I do want to get more information out there, though. It is a hot topic, and it really, you know, it's a shame because there are people out there using e-collars in a really bad way, and that's very true. I don't discount that. I think that there should be a little more policing within the balance training community, for sure. There are people out there, so you know, ruining it for everyone. But there are also a lot of people out there doing really amazing things with e-collars. And I can't imagine not having my dog's e-collar trained. I can't imagine my Spinone not being able to run free and be off leash. I think that's a really hard thing for dogs to do, for dogs to go through, and I think we need to be more cognizant of that. But again, I will say, I think more people need that. More people that are doing it right should be putting out videos. You know, it should be growing, not shrinking. No. Neighbor's dog's barking. Should be growing and not shrinking. So, I think that we definitely need to start talking about it more and start educating more because, you know, punishment is not a dirty word and negative reinforcement is not the devil's work. And you can do both of those things and not hurt the psyche, hurt the dog or hurt the dog's psyche or emotional state. That's just the way it is. You can actually, quote unquote, punish. The scientific term of punish means anything that stops the behavior or decreases the likelihood it's going to happen again. You can punish a behavior without causing emotional stress or pain in the dog. You can. So, and we need to talk and have those conversations and really talk about what that is, because I will guarantee you that everybody, 99.9% of the dog owning population, quote unquote, punishes and corrects their dog. Every single one of them. If you tell your dog, knock it off, and the dog stops, you've just corrected the dog. You've just set it right, which is what correction means, to set it right. Right? So we do need to talk about more about that stuff. And we do need to make more videos because a lot of people think that if you're using the e-collar, the dog's got the box on, they see it, they think the dog's being shocked, which, guys, it's not a shock collar. It can't shock you. There's no electricity in it. That they're being shocked if they are non-compliant, right? Or if they can be shocked if they're doing something wrong, which, if you're using it innovatively and you're using it the right way, neither of those things are true, right? You could be adding pressure to a dog that's not complying, right? But that's a whole different story than punishing a dog for non-compliance. And technically speaking, in learning theory, you can't punish non-compliance because it's scientifically impossible. Because in order for someone to be punished, in order for something to be punished, it has to stop a behavior, not make a behavior happen, right? It's completely not scientifically possible. So there is that. So here, Blue is singing the song of his people. He doesn't. He's tired and restless right now. I will answer e-collar questions, though I want to keep them to a minimum because I need to get more info, again, more information out. I don't want to it to come off like it should. Like, I don't want people going out and be like, "Oh, she said use the e-collar, put pressure on the dog," and they go buy a cheap e-collar from Petco and hurt their dog. I don't want that to happen. So, so, yeah, it can be hard to talk about those things without, I don't know. I don't want people to do that. And I know that there's a lot of trainers out there that talk a lot about it, like just say, "Oh, we did this, and we just put the e-collar on and did this, and it was great." And then they don't realize that maybe 1,000 people saw that video, and maybe 20 people went out and bought cheap e-collars and zapped their dog, just because that's what they interpreted from the video. But I will get more information about that stuff out there. I put Dasha's, I don't know if you guys can see it, but I put Dasha's link in the her link for Mars in the description or whatever of this post. So if anybody knows anyone that is looking for a feisty little Malinois with lots of love and very little defense drive. please let me know. We won't give her to anybody that's not somewhat breed aware, though. She's not just going to go anywhere because she's not just your average pet dog. Just not. I'm trying to think of what else. I was going to talk about something else. I didn't get any questions this week, so. I don't know. If anybody has any questions, let me know. Follow her on. Now's your chance. I do these lives, and then I get weird questions throughout the week, and I'm like, "You should come into the live, and I'll answer everything." It's a lot easier to do this and answer questions than write them all out on emails and stuff. We will be back next Monday at the normal time, although debating on switching to Tuesdays. I haven't decided yet. But we will be back at the normal time next Monday. Oh, there was something else I was going to talk about, and that was driving me crazy. I talked about Blue, I talked about Dasha. I started with Lou's actually gonna go home for a weekend. I'm actually gonna try doing this go home thing for the weekend, for the last 2 weekends. And then he'll come back for a week. We'll see how that goes. I want to try to spread out all the information for the go home session so that owners aren't overflowed, like flooded with information. So we'll see how that goes. All right. Well, if there is no other questions, I'll give it like another minute. And if there's no other questions, I am going to take off. Got some emails to write. But yeah, we'll be back at our normal time Monday, 7:30, maybe 8. Is it easier for 8? I don't know. Probably between 7:30 and 8, because I will probably be late, and I'll have a topic of sorts to talk about. I'm sure something will come up between now and then, or I'll get some questions emailed to me or posted, so we can go over those questions also. If you need to get a hold of me, you can go to my website, gooddogsminnesota.com, and go to the contact page and write me a message. You could also email me at kelly@gooddogsminnesota.com. And I will talk to you, answer your questions. If you're interested in dog training, go ahead and message me through there. You can visit the website for all the information and prices. And if you like what you hear, please like this and share it. Cool. I will see you guys in 6 days on Monday. Talk to you later. Bye-bye.